Greetings from the Idaho Bluegrass Association. This is Gary Eller speaking from his home in Pickles Butte, Idaho. We have prepared a series of podcasts based on interviews of people with deep roots in Idaho who rose to national prominence or otherwise made a significant impact on bluegrass music in Idaho. This series of podcasts is a collaboration between the Idaho Bluegrass Association, Idaho Songs Project, National Old Time Fiddlers Association, and Utah State University. Well, it is December the 10th, 2019, and it's Gary Eller at the Crescent Brewery in Nampa, Idaho, and we're interviewing Marv Quinton today, and I want to hear Marv talk about how he got into bluegrass, how he got an amazing bluegrass scene going in East Idaho in the 70s and 80s, and also his experiences at Weezer. So, Marv, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure, Gary, and thanks for the opportunity to share some of the stories. Well, I'm mostly from Eastern Idaho, raised pretty much all over the Northwest, but most of the time we lived in Idaho Falls and surrounding area, and been over here in the Boise area for about 15 years now, since I retired as a school principal, and just this has been our headquarters ever since.
So how did you get involved with bluegrass? That was not part of your early days. I think that came later, right?
Every Friday afternoon, we would bring all the students down at the school to the gym, and we'd have a sing-along. Now, the teachers loved this because the last 30 minutes of the day on a Friday is not a very good time for a teacher in a classroom, so they loved it, and we got a new teacher that came into the school by the name of Dave Sheldahl, and he was teaching fifth grade, and he was a musician, good guitar player, and knew a lot of songs and everything, and so he and I led this school-wide sing-along, and one Friday afternoon, after the sing-along, a lady came up to us by the name of Adina Cook, and she says, "We need you two over at our house tonight for a jam session." I said, "What's a jam session?" And she says, "You'll find out." So anyway, Dave and I went over there to their house, and this was the house of Jeff and Adina Cook, who had moved there from Missouri. He was working at the INEL. And back in Missouri, they had a bluegrass radio show on the radio, and they had two walls of music, one wall of long play albums and another wall full of old reel-to-reel tapes. So they were very steeped in bluegrass and got Dave and I both involved in it. And I said, "Well, what am I going to play?" And they says, "Well, let's try this bass over here in the corner." And they showed me a few little things on it, and pretty soon we were playing two or three times a week.
So in a way, your students got you into it.
The students and the parents at the school. So we'd have a jam session at the Cook's house every Friday night and occasional performances out around the area in Idaho Falls. A young man named Vince Croft came and joined us after about a year or so, and he was playing the banjo. He'd later become a really, really good fiddler and mandolin player and so forth, but he came and joined us, and then after a couple years, Vince and Dave and I and the Stanger brothers broke off and started another group called Knee Deep.
Well, that must have been a colorful group.
It was. Mike and Bruce Stanger, who were legends in Eastern Idaho, and everywhere they go, they're a legend in their own mind, but they are funny characters, and then Vince was a great musician, and I played the bass, just kind of kept rhythm for him, and we got to play a lot around Idaho Falls, did a lot of dances. A lot of organizations would ask us to come and play for a dance and fundraiser and so forth, as well as regular concerts and the like.
Well, some of those young students and jammers went on to greater glory, didn't they? Became quite excellent musicians.
That's true. Let me name a few of them.
Okay.
Let's say Joel Kasserman, and let's say Ben Burdick, two young men that are here in Boise now and have been here for quite a few years and very prominent in the music scene. Another young lady that played with us later on was Sherry. She married a guy named Joy McKenzie from up in Seattle, and Joey and Sherry are nationally known. They have the largest fiddle school in Texas, based in Arlington, Texas.
Then you started promoting shows.
Well, yeah, that's interesting. One day, it's probably about 1976, 77, right in there, I got a call from this gentleman, and he said, "Hello, Marv." And I said, "Yes, this is Marv." And he says, "My name is Jim. Jim McReynolds." And he says, "I'm down here in Murfreesboro, Tennessee, just outside of Nashville, and we're on tour of the West, and we heard that you might be willing to put on a concert for us. This would be Jim and Jesse and the Virginia Boys." So Vince and I decided to take it on, and we went all out, and we had to guarantee him $1,000. And after all was said and done, we actually lost $1,000. The only time that we didn't put it on is our friends in Pocatello put it on. That was Bill Monroe and the Bluegrass Boys. We had all the greats come through, most of the greats come through. Jim and Jesse and the Virginia Boys three times. Bill Monroe played in Pocatello. Hot Rise a couple of times. Then we had Country Gazette. That's Roland White and his group. Another interesting group that we had was Little Roy Lewis and the Lewis family out of Atlanta. Had the longest running gospel show on television.
Yeah, and then Little Roy is still doing his thing out there.
He is. Yeah. They're still playing. We see him on national TV once in a while. And he was a character. Of course, he was a great banjo player, but mostly an entertainer. And just kind of hopped around all over the stage pulling tricks on everybody while he played.
Well, that tells me that this series of programs was successful there.
I think it helped out. It helped the music scene because everybody knew that once every month or two, there would be a nationally recognized group coming through and performing. And quite often, after the show, they'd come over to my house and we'd have a jam session. So we got to jam with a lot of these really amazing musicians.
So probably like anything else, you get a reputation for high-quality programs, and people know it's going to be a good show when they come.
Well, it was kind of a given that we would have 250 people show up to this concert, if it was Jim and Jesse or whoever it was that was performing. We had a small auditorium there, and we could fill it up and have a great time, have a great evening. And then another thing I think that really helped was having local groups be the warm-up bands. And that was a key to keeping the music going because, you know, everybody wanted to play in a group, and so we would feature a different local band almost every time.
Oh, that's good, yeah.
Yeah.
So they would bring some of their own fans, too, I'm sure. And
Of course, their parents and their...
yeah, and their children.
and their grandparents all came to watch them. So, yeah, we would get a kind of a captive audience in that sense. This auditorium would hold 300 people, and we could usually fill it up.
Marv was a great fan of Jim and Jesse, and he performed some of their songs in various bands. Here's a recording by Marv of A Memory of You, long associated with Jim and Jesse, and first recorded in the Virginia Trio with Larry Roll, one of the first of the Jim and Jesse recordings.
Just wondering, boy, where with a broken heart, whose sweetheart and pal is now gone. The stars may be shining for somebody else, the moon may be giving its light, but all that I have is a memory of you, and I'm lost in a world black as night. To go on, I find myself wishing every day I could be with her in the beyond. The stars may be shining for somebody else, the moon may be giving its light, but all that I have is a memory of you, and I'm lost in a world black as night.
We've interviewed some of the people who were involved with the Idaho Bluegrass Association, which started in the 80s here officially in the Boise area. And they had a lot of successful concerts later than the ones you're talking about.
Right.
So they must have noticed that you were having some success there and weren't losing the house every time they had Bill Monroe come through.
Right.
Which they did. They had Bill Monroe come through Boise, and there are a lot of good stories about that trip, which we won't get into here.
Right, yeah.
But we don't see much of that these days here.
It's true.
And Bob's Barn in Nampa brought in some amazing groups in that tiny little place there. So hats off to Bob Greer in Nampa, Idaho, right, at Bob's Barn.
After the first one, we just said you get the gate minus expenses, which we could usually put it on for $100. Fortunately, in Idaho Falls, we had an ace up our sleeve, and that was that the local editor of Post Register newspaper and Channel 8 television station, a gentleman by the name of Jerry Brady, said okay. And while he was in law school back in Washington, D.C., he became a bluegrass fan, and he would often come to our jam sessions, our weekly jam sessions, and sit and listen. And anytime we had a concert, I could just go to him and say, we got this group coming in, and he says, what do you need? And we always had a couple of big stories with pictures and everything in the local newspaper. So it didn't cost a lot of money to promote the concerts. We'd make some posters and print up some tickets, and that was about it.
Well, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, you know, you could, depending on where you go, in Boise, you could spend $1,000 just renting an auditorium. That would be, in my experience, the biggest cost driver. And sound, getting some professional sound if you hire some. Those are the two biggies.
That's for sure.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
You have an interesting story about Jim and Jesse. You provided sound for these events, I take it.
Right, right.
Could you tell us about what Jim and Jesse told you to do on sound?
So I used my sound system, our mixer and speakers and everything, and would have it all set up. And the first time they came, they said, just set everything level, right across, everything straight up and level, and then don't touch it. I said, okay. And they said, we will work the mics.
And they sounded great.
And, oh, the sound was beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, they knew how to come in and out and adjust the tone of their instruments and their voices and everything. Of course, you know, by that point in their career, they had seen everything, and they had played in a lot of out-of-the-way places and had hundreds of experiences with sound systems.
Yeah, and often bad.
and often bad, and especially when you're talking about acoustic music, very seldom do you have anyone that knows anything about acoustic music and how to mic it and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, it's a common mistake I see with sound people, even professionals, that they just can't stand not to be on the board all the time. So
another little plus was that I said, now, can I record this? Now, you would think a lot of musicians would be very protective of their material. But they said, oh, of course.
Yeah.
Of course. Just, yeah, record it, you know. And so I have a box full of cassette tapes of Jim and Jesse, and Hot Rise, Country Gazette, the Lewis Family, on and on and on, all these great groups. And from time to time, I pull them out and listen to them and say, wow, that was an amazing experience.
Well, we have in Idaho right now officially two bluegrass associations. And to me, that's troublesome because there just aren't very many people in Idaho to begin with. And
right.
Bluegrass is such a narrow niche. I think we all have the same goals. We just seem to have different ways of getting there. What would you think on how to expand the reach of bluegrass in the Treasure Valley?
Well, that's a good question. I think there's an underlying fundamental about old-time bluegrass folk music. And that is, it should be unpretentious. We shouldn't be striving for perfection all the time. We should just be enjoying it and sharing it with anybody that wants to participate. And in that sense, there's quite a few people around the Treasure Valley that are doing a good job of that. But anytime we say this is an advanced jam session and only advanced musicians are allowed, that's a big mistake, in my opinion. People have to use their own judgment. People have to use some judgment and know, hey, there's a time and a place, and if they don't have any skills or they're just a rank beginner, they need to know that they need to back out. But they certainly need to be able to be invited and listen and be inspired. To be elitist about it is the opposite of what this music's all about.
One thing I've seen, if you go to concerts or jam sessions around here, it's a pretty gray-haired group of people. So how would we get more young people excited about all of this?
Take fiddling, for example, fiddling.
Yeah.
And groups like Junior Jammers and all the dedicated people that have preserved the art of fiddling. And we're in a mecca for fiddling and fiddling excellence here in the Treasure Valley. And there's a lot of people over the years that have done a great work in getting young people involved in organizations like the Junior Jammers, the Pee-wee divisions, and the teenage divisions at Weezer and so forth. And along that line, I have to take my hat off to a gentleman by the name of Slim Eller, who's done a great deal in the way of the banjo and other instruments.
Well, with the exception of Rene Redman, I'm not aware of much in the way of active outreach towards young people in bluegrass.
It's happening, though. Let me give you an example. There's a lady by the name of Emma Beck, and she had a music school for young people, and she teaches fiddle, banjo, guitar, mandolin, and they perform, and they do a great job. So there are people that are reaching out and doing it, and we have other individuals here in the Treasure Valley as well as all over the state that keep the art alive.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to take our hat off to them for their effort.
Let's listen to a song recorded by Marv with the Buckhorn Mountain Boys. Is it true what they say about Dixie? This is an old big band swing song, first recorded in 1936 by Jimmy Dorsey, a number one hit, and later recorded by everybody from Al Jolson to Dean Martin and Bill Haley and the Comets.
Swanee is a dream by that stream so sublime. Do they laugh? Do they love like they say in every song? Is it true? That's where I belong.
Switch over to talk about the Weezer Fiddle Contest. Let's start with how you got involved with it.
Well, you can't be involved in old-time music and not have heard of the Weezer Fiddle Contest. It wasn't more than a year after I got my start back in about 1977 or 78 that we ended up at Weezer.
What was your initial impression?
My initial impression was unbelievable. It was a much bigger happening in those days. It seems like there was probably maybe twice as many people that showed up to it. I don't know if people had more endurance then, or we were just more foolish then or whatever, but we didn't sleep. We would go 6 or 7 days without sleep. Maybe we'd take a nap in the afternoon, but we'd play all night. Then when the sun came up, we might stop for a while, but pretty soon the jam sessions were striking up again in the afternoon. And then, of course, evening was the time when just everybody was playing and circulating around.
Were the contestants jamming with you sometimes, too?
Pretty much the football field or the soccer field was the fiddler's domain at that time. But it was more mixed. Kerrville was there. The Institute had its people, and the football field had its people. Stickerville people would be on the football field jamming with people, and fiddlers would be over at the Institute. Contest fiddlers would be jamming over at the Institute. We had a lot of bands that would come and play, and it was this kind of a performance type situation, but quasi jam, you know. But yet you knew that you didn't jump in there.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of that happening. A couple little stories. One was probably around, I'd say maybe 1980. It's 1979, 1980. Some cocky young mandolin player, the day that they have the parade in downtown Weezer, came around early that morning and woke everybody up and said, "We're starting a bluegrass marching band, and we need everybody to participate." So it ended up that was probably maybe 100 musicians marching as a group, as a bluegrass marching band, through the parade all through town.
Playing the same song continuously, huh? Probably.
Beggar Man, Little Red-Haired Boy, I don't know if I ever want to play it again, because that was 2 hours we played that song straight. And probably 25 fiddlers leading the group, and then guitar players, mandolin players, banjo players following, and then bringing up the rear was 4 or 5 bass players, or basses on golf carts. And the interesting thing is, I can't remember exactly whether it was Bluegrass Unlimited or Pickin', the magazine, the bluegrass magazine that was prevalent all over the country at that time. Can you remember, was it Bluegrass Unlimited, maybe?
I don't remember.
Anyway, they featured this marching band. They said this is the first and largest bluegrass marching band in history. And we were a featured story in that magazine, that edition. So that was one story. Another story is about the nudist colony.
There are lots of variations on this story, so I'm interested in yours.
So, as you know, the Weezer River comes through Weezer, and as you cross the bridge and you come into town, on the east side of the bridge is an island, Mortimer's Island. And each year, in the late 50s and through the 60s, busloads of hippies would come, and they would take over that island, and that would turn into a nudist colony. Well, our friends said, "Hey, Marv," and my wife Sheila and I, and we had our 5 little kids with us. They thought they'd play a trick on us. And they said, "You've got to see what's on that island." And so we said, "Okay, sure, we'll go over. We're kind of bored this afternoon, so we'll do something." So Sheila and I, we take our kids over, and we start walking through the island. And we get out by the riverbank, by the beach. And this guy's coming walking toward us, stark naked. And my wife just, she freaked out and she says, let's get out of here, let's get out of here. But we had to walk all the way around the road to get back to the entrance where we came in. And so my kids, the oldest was 12 and the youngest was probably 3, got an early exposure to nudity. And then, of course, when we get back to the camp at the rodeo grounds, we come in and they're all waiting there. Well, how was it? A little side twist to this is that I was a Mormon bishop at the time. So this was their way of kind of dinging me a little bit here.
You've been coming continuously now for almost 40 years.
Right.
Where's it going to be, say, 20 years from now?
Well, I hope that your efforts to broaden it and to involve more people and more kinds of music and more instruments is going to help out and keep the Weezer Fiddle Festival alive and well for decades and decades to come, because the banjo component is very, very strong now, and other workshops and things that you're offering out there, the way you've remodeled the Institute buildings and so forth, I think it's just going to keep going. We need to keep cultivating it, though, and keep doing everything we can to keep it alive. But I'm very hopeful by making more kinds of music, more instruments, not just fiddles and fiddle contest, even though that's in a pretty amazing aspect of the festival.
Anything else you'd like to add about bluegrass in Idaho or the fiddle contest in particular?
Just a general idea, and that is I love playing the music and getting into a song, you know, getting into a tune and learning how to play an instrument. Being with people, it's a great experience being with people. Today we're at the Crescent Brewery and we're going to have a jam session with some of our friends here later. It doesn't get any better than that. To me, that's what this kind of music is all about. And I just hope that anybody who's interested will take advantage of it and get involved. It doesn't matter if you don't know how to play, you can learn. And a lot of people say, I can't carry a tune, I'm not musical. I actually don't buy that. There are different degrees of ability, for sure. But if a person wants to bad enough and is willing to put forth some effort, they can learn to play pretty well. And at least they can have fun. They should be able to enjoy it and have a great social experience with it.
All right, well, thanks, Marv.
You bet.
A silver moon was glowing bright on that starry summer night when my papa met sweet Jenny Marvel. All the Morgan girls were there, dancing at the Wandamere. But sweet Jenny had that raven black hair. They had come from miles around to that dance hall south of town. The sounds of Texas fiddles filled the air. Old Bob Wills was passing through with his Texas playboys too, when my papa saw that girl with raven hair. I can see them standing there, I can hear that maiden's prayer. I see them dancing to the Rose of San Antonio. She was only 17, her heart was full of romance dreams, and sweet Jenny had that raven black hair. marriage plans were all arranged. Wedding vows were soon exchanged. That's when Papa had to leave to fight the war. 7 children came along to join them in their humble home. In time, sweet Jenny's raven hair had turned to gray. Many grandkids came to play. In their heart she lives today. She saved the memories in her quilts and picture books. She had to leave, we know not why, to her mansion in the sky. If you could see her, you'd be amazed at how she looks. I can see her standing there. I can hear that maiden's prayer. I see her dancing to the rose of San Antone.